And you've had a number of players that just have basically fallen on their face, either via injury or just for the fact that they stopped hitting and they can't get a big hit to save their lives. You know, if you went to one of these guys in that locker room and said, hey, guys, if you do not get a hit the next time you're up, you're dead, the whole team would be dead. Simply because they just cannot come
through. It's pretty morbid thought.
Well, you know, but this is what I was thinking. You know, maybe you're going to need to start threatening these guys or something.
With death?
Or something.
Hugh Quattlebaum, yeah, the firing squad. Listen,
get the hell up there and swing the bat. And, you know, and as Pete Alonso said yesterday after the game, and I appreciate what Pete is saying, don't get me wrong, because if I were in his shoes, I'd probably be trying to say the same thing. I want to try to put any sort of spin on it, but it falls on deaf ears because, you know, of the way the team has played since the beginning of the All-Star break. After the All-Star break, you know, they lost 2 out of 3 to Pittsburgh coming out of the All-Star break. They are 2-8 in their last 10. And what makes it worse is that, you know, they have lost 6 out of 7 to Miami and Philadelphia. I mean, that's ridiculous.
Well, especially going after, this weekend, where they're right on your ass.
Yeah, especially after the Yankees sweep the Marlins.
Yeah.
They go down there and get their ass beat by the Marlins of all teams, one of the worst teams in the league.
Right, and then Zach Wheeler with the cherry on top of the weekend for the Phillies.
It's bothersome. And, you know, and Steve Cohen can keep putting out tweets all he wants. I went to go see the players before the game.
To the team. They're focused.
Hey, listen, this is sports, man. This is the real thing. You make it too cushy for the players, and you know there's going to be a lot of smiles in that dugout. There's a lot of guys that you know are making a lot of money in that dugout. A lot of guys that are having a really good time, but there are a lot of guys that just are not performing. I'm sorry. And if you're losing your $300 million player in Francisco Lindor, who's having a miserable year at the plate anyway, and Jacob DeGrom, you know, you obviously have to overcome those things. Now, the Yankees, for some way or how, have overcome those things. They're 8-2 in their last 10. And, you know, as you just pointed out, they have a COVID list of, like, all-stars.
Anthony Rizzo now on it, as we find out yesterday.
It's crazy.
Unvaccinated Anthony Rizzo, by the way.
Well, all right. Well, unvaccinated Anthony Rizzo. We'll see how he does.
But the Yankees also have a lot of the Johnson & Johnson breakthrough cases as well.
Yeah, I know. And they haven't been serious. And the guys have come back and they've played, okay? And that's what they should be doing. They should fight through it, come back and play. And hopefully, you know, they can patch this thing together and continue to win. So I give the Yankees a lot of credit because they've fought through all of this stuff. And the Mets, on the other hand, are in the middle, really, literally. And it doesn't matter what, you know, Pete Alonso says or what Steve Cohen says or Luis Rojas says after the game. They are in the middle of an epic collapse right now. Now, they still have time to stay in this thing.
There's a lot of time. This is not like 2007, which was the epic collapse that ended with them.
You could feel it. I mean, and that was probably because Craig had started on this radio station and had already penciled them in for a World Series. So he maloiked them in the middle, you know, right in the middle of the season.
But then the Giants won the Super Bowl and everything was fine after that.
But he didn't think they were going to win the Super Bowl, if you remember. He had to walk across the Brooklyn Bridge and got hemorrhoids because of it. By the way, why do I have a cup of pens here.
I also had a cup of pens.
That have Pete Hoffman's name on it.
Well, I guess Pete Hoffman got pens made up for his show that he does.
Yeah, they're Pete Hoffman promotional pens.
And they're doing exactly their job right now, as he left them here for us, and now we're talking about
it. So we have I have a collection of Pete Hoffman pens.
That's right.
Now, let me ask you, did Odyssey buy these, or did he buy these?
I'm sure he bought them.
Yeah, I think he bought them.
Oh, he bought them.
Yeah, we gave him a show. He gave us a pen.
How great is that?
So he has his own show now.
Well, he does a show occasionally. It says The Fight Fan, WFAN, and The Hoff, WFAN.
The Hoff.
Follow him. Marketing himself, that Pete Hoffman. Good for him.
Good for him.
He's doing a lot. He took over that Moose and Maggie show. He does like a segment an hour on there.
So now he gave us these pens, though. He left them for us? Or did somebody else give them to us?
I have no idea.
He left them in
there. He left them for us.
I think he did a show this weekend. Probably from in there.
Oh, really?
And left the pens.
I listened to a little bit of Marash yesterday. He was on. He was like doing like a stand-up comedy routine. Like he had jokes and punchlines throughout his entire open. I actually was thinking about maybe we will a little bit later. Maybe I'll have Eddie sift through a couple of these things. But he was like, it was as if he was on stage. What he was like. He's like, you know, the Mets offense is taking more days off than the WFAN full-time staff. Hey-o. I was like, Sean, come on, man.
Well, we're talking about that, too, so we're promoting him as well.
No, of course.
That's good.
But he needs some pens is what he needs.
But,
that's
you know,
what I think.
The Mets are, we all know what it is. We are right in the midst of an epic free fall.
Yeah.
I mean, without question. And we all know that. And now the question for them is, how the hell are they going to get themselves out of it?
Well, there's only one way to get themselves out of it, and that is to get healthy, and then the guys that you're counting on that are healthy actually performing to the level that we expected. And if you don't believe that those two things are going to happen and happen fast enough, they could get buried. Because, oh, by the way, that 13-game stretch we have talked about with the Giants and the Dodgers hasn't happened yet.
So let me ask you this question. If the ownership would have changed earlier, would Zach Wheeler be a pitcher for the Mets? And Marcus Stroman would not have been traded for. I understood why they traded for Marcus, because he had 1 year of control. And they knew what the number was going to be if, in fact, they kept him. So, you know, Brody, from that standpoint, under those circumstances, you know, the move looks like terrible because of what, you know, Wheeler did yesterday.
Well, what he's been doing all year, and what he's been doing in that uniform.
He may win a Cy Young, as a matter of fact. But I was saying, back when this all happened, I remember when they traded for Marcus, because at the time nobody thought that the Mets were going to be buyers at the trade deadline. But what Brody was doing, he was trying to protect the eventual loss of Zach Wheeler in the starting rotation with the addition of Marcus Stroman. So I remember thinking why he did it and how he did it, because he was under a different set of financial circumstances than, you know, Zach Scott is and Sandy Alderson are right now, supposedly.
Sure. And I do think that Zach Wheeler, his anger is toward the Wilpons, his anger is toward Brody, his anger is toward those guys. You know, of course, not towards, you know, this particular regime, but he still stuck it up the tuchus of the Mets yesterday, and he did it in the biggest way as he's shutting them down. It's just another, I mean, that game was over in a blink of an eye, because the Mets can't do anything. I mean, they can't do a thing offensively, and you don't believe it's going to get any better anytime soon. I don't want to sit here and tell you that they're cooked, because I said that with the Yankees, and Brian Cashman went out and traded for everybody.
But I think you should say that, because I think what happens is, when you say a team is cooked, usually what happens is that
it happened one time. It happened one time. No, they went out and traded for people.
I
actually don't think that they're done. I truly don't believe that they're done.
But you're a Met fan. See, like, you're not a Yankee fan. So you said the Yankee fans, this is not their season.
Yeah, it wasn't. It still has been tough with the COVID. Every time you turn around.
Yeah, but they're the Yankees. They'll figure it out. Now the Mets, you're a Met fan, so you still have in your heart your hope that somehow Jacob DeGrom will come back, somehow Francisco Lindor will come back.
When do I have hope with my teams? Well, I never have hope.
I know, but I think there's a tinge within what you're saying right now, because we are in the middle of an epic free fall.
We have
to be honest about it, and I think somebody within the Mets, whether it be Luis Rojas or somebody, has got to say, look, we know what's going on. We know we are failing. We know that we are not doing
obviously they know that.
Yeah, but they can't keep coming back with the superlatives and the spin
there's
about
no
we're going
to
be okay.
There's no way to answer those questions. So you want them to, Pete Alonso and Luis Rojas yesterday, be like, we are terrible. We can't win a game. And we're in an epic free fall, and we're not finding our way out. That's what you'd like them to say.
They got to do something. I don't know if they got to burn incense. I don't know if they got to bring the rosary beads to, you know, the dugout and into the locker room and rub the bats. Do something. I mean, something has to happen.
Like, Luis Rojas gets asked this question about, what do you have to say to the fans? It's like, come on with that question. He's like, we need fan support. Yeah, like, what the hell do you want him to say? And then with Pete Alonso yesterday, too, I know he went a little bit over the top about, just know we're going to be okay. Don't think, but just know, you know, relax, put a smile on your face, whatever. He's a goofball. That's his personality. Great. He's being positive. But when the team is playing this bad, and we've seen it year in and year out, when a team is playing this bad, there's not a damn thing the coach or the players can say it's going to make the team feel better, the fans feel better.
What did you feel like after the game? When they asked Marcus Stroman, were you up there to swing and try to hit a ball? And he said to the press that he was told not to swing.
Well, I mean, I thought about why. And I thought to myself, they're thinking they want to avoid a double play. And they want to leave it up to the hitters that are supposed to do things in that lineup that are actually asked to. And I also thought, it's about time for the frickin' DH in the National League and up with this bullcrap.
Yeah,
that's what I thought.
Here's what I thought. I thought, here's an athlete that is getting paid millions of dollars to play a sport, and he's right in the middle of the game, and he's pitching his ass off, and he can help his team win. And, you know, to have a guy tell you or a manager tell you, don't swing, and basically take every ounce of competitor out of you in that situation is like ridiculous. And I'm not saying that a pitcher can hit, and I understand your argument about the DH, and I'm with you, especially with our team, the way that it's constructed. But I also know what the internal clock of an athlete is all about and how we want to compete. That's all we want. We want to compete. And when you tell somebody not to compete, you're sending a horrific message. And then, of course, there's a double play in the next batter.
Well, right. But that's
the Mets story. And like, you're telling a player to stop competing, yet the next batter hits in a double play anyway.
Well, I mean, to me, it's just shining a light on how stupid it is that we have pitchers still hitting. I mean,
it's a bigger problem. It's like a culture problem. It's like a Met culture problem. Like, you can't tell a player to go up there and not swing unless that player is not going to swing because he's afraid to get hurt for some reason.
Yeah, which we've seen with the Mets as well.
Well, with
year.
Jacob DeGrom.
And also Taijuan Walker just stood up there for a while.
I know that, and I hate that. I hate the look of it.
Yeah.
You're giving away an out. Mm-hmm. The other pitcher knows that he's not swinging. It's like, is this baseball? Is this this is actually professional baseball where you're telling a professional baseball player not to attempt to try to help himself?
Hey.
And how many Met pitchers have helped themselves?
It's all about a numbers game, man. Analytics.
I'm sorry.
Outcomes. Percentages.
You know what? That completely sucks to me.
Percentages.
That is like, you know what? That's chicken bleep.
That's chicken bleep.
That's exactly what that is.
Chicken bleep.
I don't want to see that. I don't want to hear that. And this other thing about Zach Wilson. Well, everybody just got to calm down. I mean, oh my God, we made the wrong pick all of a sudden.
Yeah, I don't know about
that. All right, so he had a negative outing. He threw some interceptions. I'm sure he was nervous. Remember, he missed a couple days of camp. First time that he's really locked in an NFL game or NFL-like game with other NFL players on the field, probably trying to make it hard on him because they know when they get to the regular season, it's going to be even harder than it was this past weekend.
Sure.
So it's okay if they fail and they fight through it. He's a young kid. He'll get through it. Just everybody relax. I mean, it was like...
But this is what happens when you're the Jets quarterback. You know this better than anybody.
Yeah, but these are young kids. I wasn't a young kid.
Okay, fine. But you've watched the young kids come in. And every year, it feels like you have another young kid giving it a shot after all these people have failed before them. And you want a good first impression. That's what you want. So it doesn't mean he's going to be bad.
No,
but the reason why people are overreacting of is the history of the Jets and their quarterback.
Let me just put it this way. Al Dukes played on a flag football team, and he was the quarterback when the season started. Is that right, Al Dukes?
That's true.
Right. And then how many games before they yanked you out of that position because you just couldn't take it anymore?
Probably the second game.
Right. So, like, and he understands the pressure because... In that co-ed flag football league,
sure,
there was a lot of pressure on you just because of where you came from, who you work with, and there were expectations, right?
And how adamant I was about being quarterback didn't help my cause. But in fairness, the girls ran the wrong routes. I mean,
there's nothing you could do in that spot.
Right.
You just put the ball where they're supposed to be.
Yeah, but if they're not there and you throw it behind them or something and it gets intercepted, everybody looks at you like it's your fault.
Correct.
And you couldn't handle that.
I didn't care for that.
Right, just like you didn't care for being the pitcher on our softball team after you hit the wounded warrior with the ball.
Multiple times, yeah, I didn't care for that either.
Multiple times.
Get me off the field.
Yeah. Well, hopefully Zach Wilson wasn't saying that.
I don't think Zach Wilson was saying that. I thought his comments after the game, after the scrimmage, were the right comments. In other words,
meanwhile, he threw some interceptions.
Yeah, see, he did.
Yeah.
And he's going to be okay. You know, he'll be fine.
Okay.
He's going through the process of just finding out how difficult it is. And, you know, him fitting here in New York and all that stuff right now,
it's like
a weird,
it feels
weird, but hopefully, you know, he'll be strong enough mentally to get through it.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm not saying that this performance now defines his career. I'm just trying to tell you, how are you even a little bit surprised at the reaction of people being negative about it when the history of that position is as bad as it is, and this is your first impression? That's the way people are going to be. It's the way Jet fans are going to be. They're wired that way.
You know, it's interesting. The first impression on the field, watching him practice and everything, has been great.
Thank you for watching. Please like, comment, and subscribe. And don't forget to hit the red bell so you're notified when we have new content.